bombs away.
It is hard to comprehend now. It can seem so absurd, looking back from this distance at our world as the propaganda films reflected it. But it was very real.
We all thought that Americans were just standing around thinking about how to launch a missile or send us poisoned candy. To us, there was nothing human about them.
Who are the puppets?
Don't you recognize them? They're American marionettes. They do a remarkably clean job of any dirty work.
When do they switch on?
When they hear the rustle of money.
That's it? So much for American technology.
I remember they talked about parity. They said that we, too, had nuclear missiles and could threaten other countries, but we wouldn't want to.
In Moscow, the party line dictates the way of life, a way of life foreign to our American tradition. These are not free-thinking scientists following a path of experiment and deduction, regardless of where it may lead. They are skilled robots, told what to think and how to work, and the nature of the conclusions they are to reach.
They were only that stereotype who would pointed sticks up your fingernails. But after Sputnik, they became sadists with brains.
The Cold War created a world of mutual fear and threat, full of enemies. 3 years before the missile crisis, Nikita Khrushchev had become the first Soviet leader ever to visit the United States, the first Soviet leader Americans had ever seen.
We were making the half-hour drive into Washington. I still remember it. It was an absolutely astonishing sight. Crowds of people were standing along the sides of the road, waving flags, but absolutely silent. It was the silence of the tomb. It was as if the delegation and Khrushchev were from the moon. Later, I realized that was America's impression of us.
We eyed each other, President Eisenhower would say, across a trembling world.
Никита Сергеевич, вот он никогда ничего не хвалил в Америке.
Nikita Sergeyevich never praised anything in America. But when we were alone, he would say, look at what the Americans are doing. Look at that. But only to a few people, so the public wouldn't see his mouth hanging open in amazement. He rode in a helicopter with Eisenhower several times. One, two, and they'd be at Camp David. So when he came back from the trip abroad, he made his aides, including me, fly to the Kremlin by helicopter. But then the military told him, Comrade Khrushchev, don't take the helicopters. Why not? Our helicopters aren't safe. And that killed his love for that American experience.
1960. John Kennedy will challenge Richard Nixon for the presidency of the United States. The campaign will center on the issue of the Cold War, which man could best stand up to Nikita Khrushchev.
You realize that you are voting for the most important individual in the entire free world.
He shall determine whether we shall be at war or peace. This is the key office, and I run for the presidency because, like you, I have strong ideas about what this country must do. I have strong ideas about the United States playing a great role in a historic moment when the cause of freedom is endangered all over the world. That's what I think this election is about. That's what we're going to begin to do on next Tuesday. Thank you.
During the Cold War, much of the world was viewed through the struggle between the Soviet Union and the United States. That is certainly true of Cuba, an island just 90 miles off the coast of Florida that had been America's colony and its playground. Then came Fidel Castro's revolution, hailed by many Cubans as the moment of their true independence, when they defeated the U.S.-backed regime. In 1960, 13 months after the revolution, Anastas Mikoyan, Nikita Khrushchev's closest ally in the Soviet Politburo, is sent to Cuba.
We came to Cuba at the beginning of February 1960. When nobody in Moscow had any idea what kind of regime was in Cuba. My father told me at that time that this was just very much like where our revolution was young, enthusiastic, so it moved him from the very beginning.
The Soviets, particularly Khrushchev, see Cuba as the harbinger of socialism in the American hemisphere. So does the United States. Within 6 weeks, President Eisenhower will approve a covert operation designed to overthrow Fidel Castro. In the United States, John Kennedy accuses the Republican administration of losing Cuba and weakening the nation. He charges that U.S. nuclear force is inferior to the Soviet Union, that there is a missile gap. He will never tell voters he's been briefed by the Pentagon and given evidence that contradicts his claim of such a gap.
I want to demonstrate to Mr. Khrushchev and others that a new generation of Americans has taken over in this country, men who are committed to the maintenance of freedom in the 1960s.
In the middle of the presidential campaign, Fidel Castro arrives in New York to address the General Assembly of the United Nations. He is officially snubbed by the United States.
None of you, when arriving to this city of New York, has had to undergo such humiliating treatment.
Castro and Khrushchev will first meet one another during this visit to New York.
Khrushchev is good friend, good Cuban friend.
Khrushchev likes your speech.
Wonderful person. Wonderful and sympathetic.
Simpatico.
Very sympathetic. What do you want that we do? You leave us without petroleum. Khrushchev, give petroleum. You leave us without sugar. Khrushchev, buy sugar. Here, your leaders speak about aggression to Cuba. Khrushchev speak about defending Cuba. You take our plane, Khrushchev plane. Is our plane. Khrushchev is friend.
By the time John Kennedy is elected president, Fidel Castro has become a junior partner on the other side of the Cold War. So when Kennedy inherits Eisenhower's covert scheme to overthrow the Cuban leader, he faces a choice. Say yes or risk being accused of scrapping the plan to win Cuba back. It will always be remembered as the Bay of Pigs. On April the 17th, 1961, more than 1,300 anti-Castro exiles, blessed by their priest and trained by the CIA, land in Cuba with the hope that they will provoke an uprising in their homeland. CIA and Pentagon planners have assured Kennedy that Castro's small air force will be destroyed on the ground. It is not. The Cubans sink three American ships, the others steam out of the bay, leaving 1,200 men stranded. In Washington, on the second night of the invasion, the president will give a party to honor members of Congress. At midnight, after the last guests have gone, he rejects CIA and military pleas that he send in American troops. By the third day, it will be all over. Almost 1,200 men have been captured, 114 have been killed. It has been a perfect failure. John Kennedy has been president for less than 4 months. By 1961, the Soviet Union is a superpower in economic trouble. Nikita Khrushchev's plans to improve the situation depend on reducing the armed forces by more than 1 million men and cutting military spending.
I remember when my father said we were producing missiles like sausages, but we only had 2 missiles at the time. I asked him how he could say that, and he said, "What difference does it make how many missiles we have? The important thing is that the Americans believe we have a lot."
The Cold War will become a high-stakes game of chicken in Berlin, and a crucial test of nerve between the Soviet leader and the young American president. 2 months after the Bay of Pigs, Khrushchev threatens Kennedy if the West does not leave the city. 2 months after that, the Berlin border is closed to stem the flow of refugees moving from East Germany to the West.
When he was with close friends, Nikita Sergeyevich would say, "You have to know where your partner's blister is." You know, a blister, a sore spot on his finger. At the right moment, you have to squeeze it to show, "I'm here, don't fool with me." He needed to be considered an equal.
With Khrushchev squeezing on the blister of Berlin, Kennedy is compelled to look for a tender spot, too. His own defense secretary has already confirmed privately that the rhetoric about a missile gap is untrue.
We believed that there was no gap, or if there was a gap, as it turned out to be, it was strongly in our favor. At the time, there was sufficient uncertainty about it that, aside from a slip of mine in a press conference, which caused ungodly hell to break loose, we didn't discuss it publicly.
That's with the joint. You're going to do that with the Joint Chiefs, or do you want to do it with the?
In the heat of the crisis over Berlin, the president decides he will go public and confront his nuclear adversary with the truth about American nuclear might. It is a calculated move that will damage Khrushchev's ability to preserve the illusion of Soviet power.
We felt that we had to tell them that we knew there was no missile gap. So what we did, if the president had said there's no missile gap, it would have been regarded as threatening. If the Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense had said it, it would have been regarded as threatening. So we had the Deputy Secretary of Defense, Ros Gilpatrick, make a speech out in the Middle West somewhere saying there's no missile gap. You see, it's high enough to be taken seriously, but not high enough to be threatening.
It's quite possible that speech irritated people in the Soviet Union who'd been boasting about their own rockets, of whom the principal figure, the cocktail hour bomb thrower, verbal bomb thrower, was a man named Nikita Khrushchev. So in a sense, he was shown up by that speech as a bit of a faker.
The US speech confirms Khrushchev's worst fears about Soviet nuclear vulnerability. He regards himself as the head of a country with enemies right on its borders. He often makes the point to visitors at his country house on the Black Sea.
He loved to meet with American journalists, and I brought Reston and Lippmann and many others to see him. At his country house in the south, he always seated his guests facing the sea. He would tell his guard to bring the binoculars. He'd give them to, say, Lippmann, and tell him to take a look. Lippmann would say, "I don't see anything." "That's strange, Mr. Lippmann. I see American missiles in Turkey." "You say that Cuba threatens you from 90 miles away, but you threaten us from Turkey, 150 miles away. For a missile, that's nothing." It really bothered him.
April 1962.
When my father came home from work in the evening, he would always go for a walk in the meadow. We would walk around once or twice, and then he would go read his papers. And one day he said, "We're thinking." He didn't say, "We've decided about deploying missiles in Cuba. It's the only way to prevent an invasion, and I didn't sense the danger that might result from such a deployment."
Khrushchev is afraid of losing Cuba, afraid that Kennedy will decide to expand his secret CIA operation against Castro and use the military. He is also afraid of losing the nuclear arms race so badly he might invite an American first strike. His twin fears lead him to a dangerous nuclear gamble. It is a fateful gamble to deploy some of his most threatening weapons in Cuba. He names his KGB station chief in Havana to be the new ambassador and orders him to persuade Fidel Castro that the deployment is for his own defense.
Only Fidel and Raul were there, just the two of them, and Raul took notes. For the first and only time in my 8 years in Cuba, someone took notes. Fidel thought about it seriously. He didn't reject the whole idea at once, as we thought he would. He said, "Yes, it's an interesting idea."
And then my father asked him, "Did you think at the moment about your own country?" He said, "Yes, but we were determined to play our role in that worldwide confrontation, with the mortal risk for our country."
Castro says yes, believing it better, he says, to risk a great crisis than to wait impotently for the American invasion. But he argues that Khrushchev should deploy the missiles openly. Khrushchev refuses.
Neither Fidel nor I knew what the nuclear balance was. Our propaganda always said we were so powerful. We had already launched Sputniks. We thought we had enough to destroy each other, that neither country would risk war. Those nuclear weapons were only a threat, only a threat.
Nikita Khrushchev's nuclear arsenal includes medium and intermediate range missiles that are of no use against the United States because they cannot get there from the Soviet Union. But were they to be launched from Cuba, every state except Washington and Oregon would be vulnerable. The missile gap between the two superpowers would suddenly shrink. So Khrushchev plans to deploy 60 of these missiles and their nuclear warheads in Cuba in secret. It is a major undertaking.
We had to assemble the number of ships we needed without anyone noticing. We needed about 85 ships. They ultimately made 184 trips.
The Soviet Merchant Marine will transport three regiments of the Red Army to Cuba to protect the missile installations, and dozens of other regiments to defend the island against possible American attack. Never before has the Soviet Union moved missiles capable of delivering nuclear warheads outside its own borders. Never before has it moved more than 40,000 men in secret, almost 8,000 miles away. Some are sent on cruise liners, posing as vacationers. Others make the 15-day journey hidden in the holds of cargo ships. Some of them die and are buried at sea.
The men couldn't go up on deck during the day. Only at night, in small groups, could they go up for a breath of fresh air. And the trip took many days.
The
entire trip was colored by having to hide the men. The heat inside was unbearable. It was humid. We were all exhausted, steamy, hot.
Always there is the danger that the Americans will discover what is going on.
The Americans acted like they ruled the Mediterranean. They were so arrogant, if you'll forgive me for saying so, flying between the ship masts, skimming them again and again. And the situation made us terribly nervous.
When American planes flew over the ship, and they flew over several times, people who happened to have guitars or cameras got them out and acted like a group of tourists going to Cuba.
July 26, 1962. On the holiday, Cubans celebrate as their Independence Day. The first ships loaded with troops and weapons arrive.
Everything was unfamiliar. The climate, the plants, and the thought that my homeland was 10,000 kilometers away. It was strange.
The code name for the Caribbean operation is Anadir, named after a port in the Soviet far north. The Russian cover is that the troops are all agricultural specialists. But most of them can be identified by the plaid shirts they have been issued, ostensibly to blend in with the Cubans. On the island, the operation is called Checkered Shirt.
You would see 20, 30, 50 people riding in a truck, wearing the same shirts, blonde, blue-eyed. Everybody made a joke of that. The Soviets are trying to pass unnoticed, and everyone knows they're here.
If the secrecy of Operation Checkered Shirt is a joke, so is the assurance Khrushchev has been given that the missiles can be hidden as well as the men. In the late summer of 1962, Washington watches the Soviet military buildup on Cuba and worries. But U.S. intelligence advises President Kennedy that transferring nuclear missiles to the island secretly is all but impossible. As the midterm election draws closer, Khrushchev assures Kennedy privately that the buildup consists of defensive weapons only. But the Republicans accuse the president of ignoring a dangerous buildup right under his nose.
He wants a Congress that will say yes to the Russian buildup in Cuba. The American people don't want that. He wants a Congress that will say yes to continued weakness. Weakness all over this world.
I have a preliminary statement. There has been a great deal of talk on the situation in Cuba in recent days.
On September 13th, Kennedy issues a warning designed to prove to the Republicans that he will draw the line on Cuba.
Once again, if at any time the communist buildup in Cuba were to endanger or interfere with our security in any way or become an offensive military base of significant capacity for the Soviet Union, then this country will do whatever must be done to protect its own security and that of its allies.
Kennedy boxes himself in and puts on the record a threat he assumes will never be more than a threat. 2 days later, the first missiles arrive on the island. American intelligence may miss them, but they're no secret.
No, la rata eran...
The trailers were about as long as a house, and the rockets stuck out a little from behind. They were longer than the trailers, so they stuck out. If there was war or we were attacked, these were the rockets they would use.
Amidst the continuing barrage of Republican charges about Cuba, Kennedy's Secretary of Defense orders the U.S. military to intensify its plans to attack the island. A practice assault is staged against an imaginary dictator named Ortsak, or Castro spelled backwards. Inside Cuba, it looks like an invasion is about to begin. By early October, eyewitness accounts of mile-long convoys on Cuban roads can no longer be ignored. On the 14th, a high-flying American U-2 spy plane photographs Cuba, and photo intelligence in Washington first discovers six canvas-covered objects, each of them more than 60 feet long.
That phone rang, and it was the photographic interpretation guy, and he said, they're there. And we've seen them, and we know that they're missiles.
October 16th, after breakfast in the White House, the president is told. Intelligence is able to identify three missile sites in various stages of readiness. The president is forced to confront the fact that 80 million Americans, up and down the East Coast, across the South, and as far west as Dallas, are now vulnerable to Soviet nuclear attack, with virtually no warning. October 16th. Within minutes of hearing that Soviet missiles are in Cuba, the president reels off a list of 12 men to be summoned to the White House. They will form the Executive Committee of the National Security Council, or EXCOM. At 11:50 a.m., they sit down in the cabinet room and stare at the indisputable photographic evidence. Without their knowledge, the president records the meeting. Beginning, the president rejects the idea of warning Khrushchev privately lest he give him the advantage. So when Soviet Foreign Minister Gromyko arrives for a previously scheduled visit, Kennedy leaves the photographs of the missile sites in his desk drawer. Gromyko swears that the Soviet buildup in Cuba is by no means offensive. He is lying. Gromyko will cable Khrushchev that the situation is completely satisfactory, that a military adventure by the U.S. against Cuba is, in his words, almost inconceivable.
You want from me the church statement,
could you, sir?
The president, for over a year at that point, had been engaged in a very private correspondence with Khrushchev that came through a very confidential channel. And he was certain that this was Khrushchev speaking himself and therefore could be relied upon when he received messages through that channel. He received assurance through that same channel from Khrushchev that he would not put offensive weapons in Cuba. And when that turned out to be false, the president was angry because he was not a man who liked to be betrayed.
Had Khrushchev announced the missile deployment openly, he might have argued openly that he was responding to American missiles deployed in Turkey, 150 miles from Soviet soil. His duplicity robs him of that option.
be utterly wrong, but we never really believed that Khrushchev would take on a utility if the war over Cuba.
Can I ask a question in that?
We certainly have been wrong about what he's trying to do in Cuba. We think one thing Mr. Khrushchev may have in mind is that he knows that we have a substantial nuclear superiority, but he also knows that we don't really live under fear of his nuclear weapons to the extent that he has to live under fear of ours. Also, we have weapons nearby in Turkey and places like that.
Many weapons do we have in Turkey?
We have the nuclear missiles.
We have them in about 15, I believe. I think that's right.
There is agreement in XCOM that the Soviet missiles must be removed. But how? And how do they even begin to assign risk to the various options?
Many of the people in the discussion really felt strongly that it would be immoral. It would be like Pearl Harbor for us to attack a small country like Cuba. And that we shouldn't do that, regardless of the political consequences. And there were others of us, of whom I was one, who thought, well, you know, the Russians were being very mean to everybody in the world, or the Soviets, and we were entitled to stand up.
Well, there were, of course, on the XCOM, some people who did not think moral questions entered into great power relationships. As one participant said, when the Russians put steel forward, it must be met by steel, otherwise they will proceed, and we must meet this by steel.
I don't believe myself that the critical question is whether you get a particular missile before it goes off, because if they shoot those missiles, we're in general nuclear war. The Soviet Union has got quite a different decision to make.
We don't know what kinds of communications the Soviets have with those sites. We don't know what kinds of control they have with warheads.
We're now considering these then Soviet missiles,
Soviet offensive capability. We have to consider them Soviet missiles.
There seems to me if we go in there, lock, stock, and barrel, we can consider them entirely Cuban.
What we say for political purposes and what we think are not identical here. But I mean, any rational approach to this must be that they are Soviet missiles, because I think Putin himself would never risk a major war on a fellow who is obviously erratic and foolish as his custom.
I would say, of course, one other thing is whether we should also think of whether there's some other way we can get involved in this through Guantanamo Bay or something, or whether there's some ship that, you know, sink the main again.
There was at first some talk about there would be a surgical airstrike. That was a term that was sort of in vogue at the time, which, you know, all you had to do was, even then we had weapons, some of which could be fairly precise. You just go in and take out a few sites, and then that would end the problem.
If you want to start a nuclear war, that's the way to do it, because you, God knows that you can't tell what you do. Once you do something irrevocable, then you've done it. Then there's no way you can negotiate your way out of it, because the damage has been done. And the requirement on the other side to react becomes almost irresistible.
Had the president acted on XCOM's advice the first day, he would have ordered an immediate airstrike on the missile sites. But there were too many questions.
You have to put a blockade in following any limited action.
Then we're going to have to sink Russian ships, right. And we're going to have to sink Russian submarines. Now, whether it wouldn't be the argument, if you're going to get into it at all, whether we should just get into it and get it over with and say that take our losses, and if we're going to... He wants to get to a war over this. Hell, if this war is going to come on this thing, or he sticks those kinds of missiles in it, it's back to the warning. And he's going to get into a war for 6 months from now or a year from now. So.
At that point, Dean Acheson leapt into the debate. If somebody objected to the word blockade, why did you have to use that word? Why not quarantine?
It's a great achievement, because it has to do with the international law of blockade, which is an act of war, or can be so interpreted, whereas a quarantine is just keeping some infection out of the area.
There was a great danger that the quarantine, once started, would slip out of control and escalate very substantially. That's why I slept in the Pentagon for 12 nights, to try to keep a lid on that situation.
By the end of the third day, aware of the risks, XCOM seems ready to recommend that the president impose a quarantine. And then over dinner, the wife of Kennedy's national security advisor asks her husband if they have done everything possible to avoid war.
But that Thursday evening, I thought we ought to have another look, and made a brief argument to that effect.
The XCOM meeting in the State Department seemed to have reached a consensus. We went over to meet the president at the White House very late at night. He heard us out, nodded gravely, and then one of our members went off in a totally different direction, in the direction of saying, I'm not so sure any action is required at all. A legitimate point of view, but frustrating the president when he thought that a consensus had been reached.
The Kennedy brothers thought it would be great if everybody always agreed. Life is not quite like that.
The next morning, he met with the Joint Chiefs of Staff before he departed for his the campaign trip that he wanted to maintain to keep appearances of normalcy. And he found the Joint Chiefs not only divided among themselves, but again insisting that there had to be a military strike solution. And he stepped out of his office and said to me, you and Bobby have got to push this to a consensus soon because time is running out, and call me back as soon as you have.
As the president campaigns in Chicago, in Washington, XCOM continues its secret meetings, sometimes coming and going through an underground tunnel from the Treasury Department to the White House. On Friday, they receive startling new aerial pictures of Cuba. Some of the missiles are apparently in a position to be launched. It is now up to one single man, Robert Kennedy will say, and he summons his brother back to Washington. The president orders his press secretary to tell reporters he has a cold.
He said, I want you to call a press conference and announce that we're calling off the rest of the trip. And so I went down, held a press conference, and the president walked out of the building with a coat and a hat on. He didn't he didn't wear hats very normally. And we got on the plane. And about halfway to Washington, I suddenly found myself alone in the president's cabin. I said, what is going on? Well, he said, when you find out, you'll grab your balls.
Rumors, I suppose you'd call, that there were other reasons aside from the cold that brought the president back. Is there anything to that?
The president returned to Washington because of his cold.
Does he have any activity at all scheduled?
He does not.
Stay in his room?
Plan to stay in his room, that's correct.
Saturday, October 20th. In 5 days, the president has gone from outrage to fear and now to caution. He chooses the quarantine, but he will also try to appease those pressing for stronger military action with a promise. If the quarantine is not effective within a few days, he will authorize an airstrike followed by an invasion of Cuba. He asks the networks for television time on Monday night and orders the military to prepare. Moscow, October 22nd. Khrushchev will be given Kennedy's speech in advance.
I took over the text of the president's speech. We had to deliver it 1 hour before he began. So that was 1 a.m. in the morning in Moscow. When I handed the young officer, V.V. Kuznetsov's special assistant, the packet with the president's letter to Khrushchev and the text of his Monday evening speech. He asked me, he said, I'm afraid this is bad news for us. And I said, well, you'll have to decide that for yourselves after you read it.
In the Kremlin, they fear Kennedy will announce that the invasion of Cuba is already underway. For Nikita Khrushchev, the Caribbean crisis has begun. Monday, October 22nd. As the nation anxiously waits for the president to speak, thousands of troops and thousands of tons of equipment are already moving into position in Florida and Georgia. Air Force fighters and bombers are put on alert. Almost 300 Navy ships steam towards Cuba, preparing to impose the quarantine at sea. Three Marine battalions arrive to reinforce the American naval base at Guantanamo on the northern coast of Cuba itself. Wives and children of military personnel are ordered to evacuate. For Americans, the public phase of the missile crisis is about to begin, and it will be terrifying.
I have directed that the following initial steps be taken immediately. First, to halt this offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment under shipment to Cuba is being initiated. I have directed the continued and increased close surveillance of Cuba and its military buildup. Should these offensive military preparations continue, thus increasing the threat to the hemisphere, further action will be justified. I have directed the armed forces to prepare for any eventualities. It shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
For many in the television audience in countries all around the world, nuclear war between the United States and the Soviet Union now seems imminent.
I know that some action should be taken, but he's going to have to tread very lightly, short of war. He's on dangerous ground and skating on thin ice.
I don't know. I feel worried. I mean, I feel that something could happen. I'm worried for my kids, mostly. I don't know.
And despite all the duck and cover rehearsals, there is a certain feeling of helplessness about it all.
I'm here because I feel completely hysterical about the world situation. I don't know what else to do.
Are you planning on building a shelter?
No, I don't think there'll be time.
Khrushchev's reaction was very emotional. Why they can demand us to stop our ships? They do not have any right to do it. So he was very emotional and he did not order the ships to stop.
He was alarmed and furious. He was furious with our military who hadn't hidden it all properly. He was really furious with the military.
When Marshal Berezov came back from Cuba, they said they could disguise the missiles as palm trees. How they decided that palm trees look like missiles, I don't know. I was astounded, and I asked Father how they'd do it. He brushed it off and said, well, they're professionals, they know better. When I reminded him about this later, he told me to mind my own business. And that was the end of the discussion.
Khrushchev is belligerent, and he considers a blockade, whatever the Americans choose to call it, an act of war.
They said they had every right to do this. We had no right to stop them, that this was a violation of international law. That's all perfectly correct. But it was clear we were going to do it, regardless.
In Cuba, the president's speech brings no surprise. For 18 months since the invasion at the Bay of Pigs, Cubans have believed Kennedy would try again. So for them, it is the crisis of October, little different from any other month.
Кубинский народ считал.
The Cubans believed that the Soviets were stronger than the Americans, that nothing would happen. There was absolute calm after the speech. The Americans had been threatening them constantly for years. They were used to it. I was charmed by them, hypnotized, so I was very calm too. In Cuba, people just didn't know what nuclear weapons were, you see.
Castro also speaks on television and orders 270,000 people to take up arms.
Our commander-in-chief, Fidel Castro, gave the order for combat. Immediately, everyone began to prepare. Throughout the country, there was a large-scale mobilization.
What we could not do was surrender. We were determined to defend our ideas, to defend above all the country's independence.
In Moscow, the streets are silent. The state-controlled press plays down any danger. On Tuesday night, the 23rd, Khrushchev appears at the Bolshoi, indulging in a bit of theater for foreign eyes.
He decided to demonstrate that everything was fine and he was calm. His guard called me and said, "I'll send a car to take you to the Bolshoi Theater." Father loved the Bolshoi and the theater in general, so I happily got dressed and we went to the Bolshoi.
Eight hours later, Tuesday night in Washington, Soviet ships are within 12 hours of reaching the American quarantine. The president tries to communicate danger directly to Khrushchev and secretly sends his brother Robert to visit the Soviet ambassador in his embassy. In a cable never before made public, Ambassador Dobrynin writes to Moscow. Robert Kennedy was clearly upset. "The president feels deceived," he said, "and was very affected by the personal message from Khrushchev, saying that during the U.S. electoral campaign, the Soviets would do nothing that might aggravate relations between our two countries." The president believed everything and put his political career on the line. He feels deceived. As he was saying goodbye at the door, the ambassador continues, Robert Kennedy waved his arm in despair and said, "I don't know how this will all end, since we intend to stop your ships." That night, Khrushchev will not leave the Kremlin. Robert McNamara will not leave the Pentagon. And George Ball will stay all night in his office at the State Department. In the White House, the president will tell his brother, "The great danger in all this is a miscalculation, a mistake." Wednesday morning, October 24th, 36 hours after the president's speech. If the Soviets do not yield, a shooting war between the two nuclear superpowers may begin at sea. Robert Kennedy tells his brother that if he had not acted, he would have been impeached. "That's what I think," the president will say. "I would have been impeached." "150 American ships have now isolated Cuba. 25 Soviet ships are steaming towards them. The Americans have orders to stop any Soviet ship and board. If there is resistance, the orders are to fire." Then at 10:25 a.m., military intelligence reports to the White House, 16 Soviet ships have either stopped dead in the water or turned back. The hawks around the president who opposed the quarantine are not happy. There's been no showdown.
"I thought that what we should do is to pursue that particular ship, which was a deep-hulled ship, which probably had missiles aboard it. Pursue it and board it, and then bring it back to the United States and demonstrate to the world that there really were missiles aboard and that the Russians had been lying from word go. And we demonstrated that we were full of determination and we could shove it in their face."
Most of us remember that moment the ship stopped as the moment the crisis ended. The world did not know what the White House knew.
We knew that the crisis was far from over when the ships turned around. They could come back at any time. The missile site work was going ahead. We did not know whether the Soviets already had on Cuba all the warheads and other materials that they needed to make those missiles operational. We moved on.
Over the next 48 hours, from Wednesday until Friday, the crisis will actually become more acute in all three countries. But attention is focused on the diplomatic theater at the United Nations.
Let me ask you one simple question. Do you, Ambassador Zorin, deny that the USSR has placed and is placing medium and intermediate range missiles and sites in Cuba? Yes or no? Don't wait for the translation, yes or no?
For 3 days, Soviet diplomats in New York and Washington hear not a word from Moscow.
I am not in an American courtroom, sir, and therefore I do not wish to answer a question that is put to me in the fashion in which a prosecutor does. In due course, sir, you will have your reply.
I am prepared to wait for my answer until hell freezes over, if that's your decision.
The absence of any information or instructions gave us a clue to the confusion in Moscow. And it increased our alarm about how the crisis would unfold. Moscow was silent.
The silence will grow increasingly ominous. In Cuba, work on the missile sites is forging ahead. And President Kennedy orders low-level reconnaissance missions to fly over the island twice a day.
We could even see their faces as they flew near Havana. As we watched them, we'd make a certain gesture. They'd do the same back to us.
We were insulted. It was an offense for the U.S. Air Force to enter our country, to fly over our territory, to try to provoke a conflict.
American aircraft can monitor progress on getting the huge missiles ready to fire, but they cannot see the nuclear warheads that would enable those missiles to deliver catastrophe. Washington can only guess.
Now, those container buildings, storage buildings for warheads, were not completed. They never were completed. They were half built. I doubt very seriously if they would have sent the warheads until the storage facilities were complete. So there's a, I don't think air warheads ever got there.
We delivered 42 medium range missiles in all, of which 6 were mock-ups for training. So that was 36 missiles with their warheads.
Each warhead was 1 megaton, that is 50 Hiroshimas. That's a terrible force.
In addition, there were also 6 tactical lunar installations. These are battlefield missiles with a range of about 40 kilometers.
Washington knew about missiles that could reach the U.S. heartland. They did not know about the nuclear-tipped short-range weapons that could be used against an American invasion force.
We had brought in 12 nuclear warheads for them.
The 12 Lunas, each with a range of only 25 miles, are deployed along Cuba's coast, in the places the Soviets expect U.S. landing forces will try to come ashore. In the White House, they do not know what is on the ground in Cuba, not the number of troops, nor weapons, nor about the warheads. And as each day goes by with no concession from the Soviets, the drumbeat for military action grows more insistent. The president's advisors are split over whether Khrushchev would retaliate.
I never for a minute thought that the Russians would initiate something that they knew would lead to nuclear war against them.
I thought it was unlikely. And I thought we could have much more confidence in putting it to them than they could have in putting it to us.
That's the reason some of my associates believed they wouldn't respond. It would not have been intelligent for them to respond, was the view of my associates. My view was it would not have been human for them not to respond.
In Moscow, it is not a question of if, but how. There are 42,000 Soviet troops in Cuba. They have no conventional means of defending themselves if the Americans attack. The authority to launch the strategic nuclear weapons is tightly controlled by Khrushchev. The authority to use battlefield nuclear weapons is another matter.
Когда меня инструктировал министр обороны, маршал Советского Союза Родион Яковлевич Малиновский.
When the Minister of Defense, Marshal Malinovsky,
он меня так
gave me my orders.
Тактические Луна.
He said this. Regarding the tactical missiles, the Lunas, repeat to the commander, as Nikita Sergeyevich has ordered him, that in a certain situation, if there's no way to contact Moscow, and hostilities have broken out, if there is an invasion and war has already begun, then he has the authority to use the tactical weapons himself.
Принимать самому решение на использование тактического оружия.
Да, конечно, командующий принимал решение.
The commander would have decided on his own. What were the options?
Война есть война.
War is war.
Понимаете?
Moscow was far away, and communications weren't very good. So he had the authority.
President Kennedy orders U.S. strategic forces to a higher level of alert. Nuclear war is less and less an abstract possibility. More and more, it is real.
To show our seriousness and to show our willingness to wage nuclear war if necessary, for the first time, the Strategic Air Command went to Defense Condition 2, which is the second level, which means you are prepared to conduct operations when so ordered. The Strategic Forces of the United States were prepared to act if called upon.
Defense Condition 2, in military shorthand, DEFCON 2. Were the president to escalate to DEFCON 1, the U.S. military would be fighting a nuclear war.
I don't think they did a lot of alternative planning for particular kinds of nuclear strikes. What they did, which is much more serious, was to engage in a process of alerting of their forces, which in their own view, the Air Force's view, was designed as a powerful signal to Moscow. And I at least didn't know about that at the time. And don't believe that that kind of use of strategic forces for diplomatic signaling should happen without presidential approval. So that was very much of a loose end.
The commander of strategic forces was freelancing. Without authority, he sent the Soviets his own message by ordering DEFCON 2 over open lines.
I was talking to friends and generals, and General White in particular, chief of the Air Staff, and going up and having supper with him one night up there at Fort Myer, and we were looking out over the Washington Monument, and he said, "I can't get out of my mind the picture of what that would look like in the event of a nuclear weapon dropping on Washington. Oh, everything charred in this one monument, perhaps standing up against a blackened earth." So clearly, General White was deeply concerned. But I don't remember that I was. I was I think, too busy and too involved in it.
But there wasn't much point in being frightened. I mean, you know, case said I, said I. What was going to happen was going to happen, and nothing any of us could do would affect that or change it. So you just had to go ahead and do what you were supposed to do and hope and pray.
By Thursday night, almost 1,500 strategic bombers have been put on constant alert. 200 are in the air at all times. All the aircraft are carrying nuclear weapons. 145 intercontinental nuclear missiles are ready to fire. Every one of them is targeted on the Soviet Union. Never before, and never since, has the United States moved to this state of nuclear alert. Friday, October 26th. Soviet and Cuban intelligence report in detail American preparations for a massive invasion of Cuba. Behind its calm facade, the Kremlin is in chaos. Khrushchev knows what Kennedy does not, that his commander on the ground has battlefield nuclear weapons and the authority to use them.
It was hard for Khrushchev. He was alone. For all his inexplicable, confused, complex, unrealistic doctrine, he was alone, you see, alone.
In his Kremlin office, Khrushchev will write a letter to the president. "You are threatening us with war," it begins. Just before 5 o'clock, the streets already dark in the early Moscow winter, a breathless courier will arrive at the U.S. Embassy delivering the letter from Khrushchev. It will take 10 long hours to get to Washington. "Mr. President," Khrushchev writes, "we ought not to pull on the ends of the rope in which you have tied the knot of war, because the more the two of us pull, the tighter that knot will be tied. And a moment may come when it will be tied so tight that we will not have the strength to untie it. And then it will be necessary to cut the knot, to doom the world to the catastrophe of nuclear war." Friday morning, October 26th. For the first time, the United States will actively enforce its quarantine of Cuba. A Lebanese freighter under charter to the Soviets is stopped and searched by the USS Joseph Kennedy. The president signals his firmness to the Soviets and his determination to the hawks in Washington.
"Boarding party returned 10:20 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time. No prohibited material in evidence."
He has chosen to search a ship he believes unlikely to have weapons on board. He does not want, he says, to put Khrushchev in a corner from which he cannot escape. At about the same time, Khrushchev's letter to Kennedy arrives at the U.S. Embassy in Moscow. In the 10 hours it takes to reach the White House, Kennedy will know nothing of his adversary's fear. During those crucial hours, ABC News correspondent John Scali gets a phone call from the KGB chief in Washington, who insists they meet right away.
"And the waiter interrupted us for ordering whatever food that we had. And then he leaned forward, he says, there may be a way to solve this. He said, and he went right to the point. He says, could you find out from your high State Department friends? And by that, I knew he meant the Secretary of State, what they would think of a proposal whereby we would remove the missiles from Cuba under United Nations inspection. We would promise never to introduce such offensive weapons into Cuba again. And would the United States in turn be willing to pledge publicly that it would not invade Cuba?"
It is one of several signals that the Soviets may be looking for a way out. XCOM receives intelligence that work on the launch pads in Cuba has accelerated. The president orders the overflights increased from twice a day to once every 2 hours. Soviet commanders know that with every reconnaissance flight, their positions are more and more vulnerable to an American airstrike. They repeatedly ask Moscow for permission to shoot. Moscow is silent. Ambassador Alexeyev cables Khrushchev that Castro has told Soviet generals it is essential to shoot down one or two piratical American planes. Washington is unaware of what is happening.
We've looked at this as a Soviet United States confrontation that was happened to take place on the soil of a Soviet satellite, which was Cuba. So if we could get the Soviets to deal to pull these missiles out, they'd put them in. Oh, and we knew they had the authority to pull them out if they wanted to. That was all right. We weren't at that. We didn't like Castro. We disliked him intensely, but we weren't fighting with him about this. He had nothing to say about it, as far as we were concerned.
At almost the same moment that Kennedy in Washington escalates, ordering the overflight stepped up, Castro escalates too, ordering his anti-aircraft guns to fire at every plane coming in.
We fired at the airplanes that passed over our anti-aircraft batteries, and we did it to shoot them down. We weren't shooting as part of a game.
Neither Washington nor Moscow seem to consider what it looks like from Cuba's point of view. The Cubans are convinced the American invasion is only hours away.
The Cubans really insisted we use our weapons. Why else did you come here? Use your weapons. Fire. They were ready for war. Maybe they believed so strongly. They were ready to sacrifice themselves. They would say, Cuba will perish, but socialism will win. They were ready to sacrifice themselves.
By Friday afternoon, the Soviets have moved many of their nuclear warheads from storage to the launch sites. They can be mated with their missiles in a matter of hours. The ambassador cables Khrushchev, we have taken all necessary measures.
Fidel took out a cigar and said, I really enjoy good tobacco. Let me smoke this. I don't know if it may be my last.
I remember that night. We all said goodbye because no one thought we were going to see the light of day. It was a very dramatic moment, a very beautiful moment. No one was afraid.
At 3 a.m. Saturday morning, Castro goes to the Soviet embassy. He spends the rest of the night there writing an emotional plea to Khrushchev. As Ambassador Alexeyev struggles to translate Spanish into Russian, he asks the Cuban leader, do you mean the Soviet Union should be the first to strike a nuclear blow? I do not want to say this directly, Castro replies, but if they attack Cuba, we should wipe them off the face of the earth. Saturday, October the 27th. This will be the most dangerous day. At 10 o'clock the night before, the president and his advisors finally receive Khrushchev's first letter, what one of them calls a cry of the heart.
We have a letter that's come in the night before, which is the famous personal letter that goes on and gets delayed in transmission and comes in four parts, and part four arrives before part two. And McNamara says there's nothing in this because there's no sensible argument in here. And that's very McNamara and not quite right. And we spend a great deal of time sorting out what is in that message overnight. Then we get the second message. What the hell is that all about? He says, you take yours out of Turkey and I'll take mine out of Cuba and we'll all be all set.
By delivering his second message via Radio Moscow, Khrushchev has raised the stakes.
President Kennedy, This is unsettling because he's got us in a pretty good spot here. Because most people will regard this as not an unreasonable proposal. National Security Advisor Bundy. What most people, Mr. President? President Kennedy. We can't very well invade Cuba with all its toll when we could have gotten the missiles out by making a deal on the same missiles in Turkey. If that's part of the record, I don't see how we'll have a very good war.
The president was annoyed as hell because the Jupiters were junk. Nobody disputed that.
Kennedy refuses to make a deal, as he puts it, with a gun pointed at my head.
But my God, why do we go to war over a myth? And there was that issue. But myths sometimes are very important. They're, in a sense, more important than reality. And that was the case here. We couldn't just jerk those missiles out of Turkey without weakening the whole of NATO. And what would have happened then?
As they wrestle with the conflicting messages from Moscow, fearful that Khrushchev is losing control, an American U-2 spy plane is shot down over Cuba. Its pilot is killed. Shooting down the U-2 was not sanctioned by Moscow. In Washington, they do not know that.
When our men found out that Fidel had given the orders to his artillery to shoot down low-flying planes, our men decided to do the same, to help out. There wasn't time to ask Moscow. When the U-2 appeared on the radar, there were only 20 minutes. They called the commander, but he wasn't there. So, two members of the military council decided to shoot the plane down. They shot it down.
In Moscow, Khrushchev will face the bleakest moment of the crisis. He does not know if his own generals in Cuba have disobeyed him. He is not sure who is in charge.
He was very upset that some fool might start a war. When I said, "We've finally shown the Americans our strength," he said, "You don't understand a thing. It's very dangerous."
An hour later, the Soviets discover an American U-2 in their airspace over Siberia. MiGs are ordered to intercept it.
And this pilot had turned around and picked the wrong star to go back. And he was over the Soviet Union, and you could hear him screaming over the radio. You see, I could hear him screaming in his phone. The MiGs are scrambling. You know, I can see them, he said. I can see them. They're falling out. They're missing me, but they're scrambling. Give me a sight home. You see, he was over the Soviet Union. He'd violated Soviet airspace. I dropped the phone and ran upstairs to tell the president. Of course, I hadn't had any sleep for 36 hours, and that had been preceded by 10 days of 4 hours a night. And so I blurted this message out, and it was a terrible calm. You know, Mac Mundy was there, Mrs. Lincoln and the president, and a couple other people. And everybody was thinking, oh my God, the Soviets think that this is a reconnaissance for a first strike. They may be counting down right now.
Here is an American action of a reconnaissance plane off course over the Soviet Union that we did not control. So that both sides are getting reminders that crisis managers don't always manage everything.
Secretary of Defense McNamara, we must be in a position to attack quickly. We've been fired on today. We're going to send surveillance aircraft in tomorrow. Those are going to be fired on without question. You can't do this very long. You're going to lose airplanes, and we'll be shooting up Cuba quite a bit. We're going to lose airplanes every day, so you can't just maintain this position very long. We must be prepared to attack Cuba quickly.
The noose was tightening, the president's brother would say. The bridges to escape were crumbling.
I was scared to death that the president might be persuaded by the hawks to go ahead and do something, which would start a process which was an irrevocable process. And that was the key to my anxiety. I thought, I had a feeling of helplessness, that I felt I can't outshout these other people.
Как вокруг Кеннеди были ястребы,
Just as Kennedy was surrounded by hawks, there were hawks here, too. They egged him on. So Kennedy restrained his hawks, and Khrushchev restrained his. That's the most frightening thing. The influence of these people.
Who'd come out on top?
Who'd come out on top? The militarists or people of a more liberal bent who
had some sense.
Had more sense.
We had called up reserves. We had moved ships and we moved aircraft to the southeastern United States. We had a plan for putting at sea and an invasion force of 180,000 men to be landed on Cuba with a first-day air support of 1,080 attack sorties. It was a huge potential invasion.
We were within 24 hours or less of doing it. I mean, everything was ready. And we went down, I went with the Admiral down to Fort Stewart, and we saw the guys down there in Key West. We were not just sitting in Norfolk by a long shot. Went out to Carrier, and so we had a good feel, and they were all gung-ho, ready, ready. I mean, they had slept with their weapons, and the planes were there, and the thing was all set. So it was just a matter of a telephone call. Say, go, man, go.
If an invasion by air or sea had occurred, we would have had to fight them. We would have retaliated.
The Americans would have lost more than they lost during the whole World War II. And of course, our losses in Cuba would be all those 42,000 people and missiles. And I cannot imagine Khrushchev do not making some kind of response.
Sure, there would have been casualties, lots of them. But the risks were high and the stakes were high. And I didn't think that we ought to be deterred by that, good gosh.
The president knows that if there is an invasion of Cuba, it will match in scope the D-Day invasion of Europe. He does not know that the Soviet commander on the ground has the authority to resist using battlefield nuclear weapons. At 7:45 that night, Robert Kennedy summons Soviet Ambassador Dobrynin to meet him at the Justice Department. The president will agree, he tells the ambassador, to move American missiles out of Turkey. But the deal is secret. Only a handful of Kennedy's own advisors know. If it becomes public, it will be denied. It is the final American offer. Khrushchev has 24 hours to respond.
The game is moving. We'll know in the morning. It's the other fellow's move. We'll know what his moves are. We can't do very much till we know what those moves are. So it simplifies, but it's a little bit like a tight chess match. When you adjourn overnight and you've made your move, you can think about what you're going to do if he does this or that or the other thing, but you don't have to do it. You can't really do it till you know what his next, what his response is.
I was walking through the Rose Garden of the White House. It was a spectacularly beautiful day. I can't think of a nicer day. And I said to Bob McNamara, who was walking with me, you know, this reminds me of a painting of Georgia O'Keeffe of the skull with the rose penetrating it. And that's exactly the kind of macabre sense we all had.
And although this sounds melodramatic, I don't mean it that way, but you ask what was the mood at the time, I thought I might never live to see another Saturday night.
We walked out of the meeting together and decided to go out into the park for, you know, walk for a few minutes. And he turns to me and says, do you realize that if I make a mistake in this crisis, 200 million people are going to get killed?
We had not abandoned hope, the president's brother would say. But what hope there was now rested with Khrushchev. And it was a hope, not an expectation. The expectation was a military confrontation by Tuesday, possibly tomorrow. Sunday, October 28th. In Moscow, Khrushchev and his advisors have been meeting all night, Just before 2 a.m., they learn of Fidel Castro's letter, written 36 hours before. Khrushchev understands the Cuban leader to be urging the Soviets to launch the first nuclear strike. He is unnerved. And then just before dawn, he receives a cable from his ambassador in Washington describing the conversation with Robert Kennedy the night before. It was somewhere between a threat and a prayer, Khrushchev would say. The president both demanded and begged. It is clear to him that he's out of time. He rushes to broadcast his answer to Kennedy live over Radio Moscow. In exchange for an American promise not to invade Cuba, he will pull his missiles out. Khrushchev agrees to move the missiles out of Cuba on the decks of Soviet ships in full view. His generals describe the withdrawal as humiliating. Castro calls it betrayal.
We were faced with a true betrayal. Fidel said, after everything we have done, after having given over everything that we own, including potentially the lives of our people, look what they've done to us, Carbello.
Castro first hears of Khrushchev's concession on the radio, and he is furious. The Soviets have treated Cuba like a bargaining chip, he says. He does not believe the vague American promise not to invade. Ambassador Alexeyev would later say that Khrushchev deliberately avoided consulting Castro, afraid that doing so might have delayed his answer to Kennedy by even a few hours.
Now, assume for the minute that that force had been directed to attack Cuba and invade, they almost surely would have been confronted by nuclear fire from the Soviet forces. Imagine the headlines. Youthful U.S. president sends American boys to be killed by Soviet nuclear weapons without equipping them to defend themselves.
Something that would have required us to react with nuclear weapons of some in some way. And just where, God only knows. The obvious place was some would be directed at Soviet soil in some way.
Видите, на каком волоске
nuclear catastrophe was hanging
вот это
by just a thread.
И что решали,
and we weren't counting days or hours, but minutes.
The public thinks the danger is over. It is not. Kennedy demands that Soviet bombers be withdrawn along with the missiles. Castro balks. Khrushchev stalls. U.S. nuclear forces will not be taken off alert until the bombers are removed 22 days later. The two men who have come so close are fundamentally changed by the experience.
Our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's futures. And we are all mortal.
He told my mother, you should write Jacqueline words of condolence. Today, it all seems natural. But at that time, it meant much more. After all, for us, Kennedy represented the enemy. That's the only word for it. So it was a big psychological turning point for my father when he said that. And this, too, was one of the results of the missile crisis. That they were no longer symbols of a terrible capitalist or a terrible communist, as we had thought all those years. For the first time, they saw each other as real human beings.
Both leaders will use the word insane to describe what they have been through. insane, the president will say, that two men sitting on opposite sides of the world could bring an end to civilization. Insane, Mr. Khrushchev will say, not to have been scared. Well, to understand why, the American president and the Soviet premier knew precisely how close they had come. 9 months later, the two countries signed the very first nuclear arms treaty between them, banning nuclear testing in the atmosphere. Mr. Kennedy and Mr. Khrushchev had learned something. It is irresistible to wonder whether the world would have changed as it now has sooner, because the only two men ever to stare down the gun barrel of nuclear war had been so changed themselves by the experience. But Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas 12 months after the crisis ended. Khrushchev was removed from power 11 months after that. I'm Peter Jennings. Good night.